By the way, what was your impression, Mr. Ambassador, about the Voiku case, about what came publicly with the transcripts?
Well, I was very disturbed with what I saw in the transcripts. But I the one thing I want to say about the Voiku case is, at least with respect to arrest and prosecution and legislative immunity, I think that case illustrates the point that your system can work, and it did work there. You had a very effective prosecutor who made a good case. The Free Press weighed in. There was a vote to waive legislative immunity. It was a close vote. It was a secret vote, which bothers me. But it happened, and legislative immunity was waived, and Senator Voiku was arrested, and he's in jail. That's good. Now, you know, the problem we have going forward is what will happen in the prosecution. Are your procedures good enough to result in a conviction? I don't know the answer to that. I do know that you're looking at fundamental reforms here, which are good. I do know that there appears to be bipartisan support for some of the reforms that I think are necessary that would result in a conviction. It may not apply in this case, but it could apply in future cases, and I'm happy to see that.
We had, Mr. Ambassador, we had here at the Hot News Mr. Gary Dixon, the chief of the FBI office in Bucharest, on an interview, pointing out the issue of the internet fraud. Did you notice any improvements in this regard?
Yes. Well, Gary's done a very good job. He's our FBI guy in the office, and he works very closely with our Secret Service, DEA, and other enforcement organizations. And we've had a lot of success. I think we've had over 100 arrests and prosecutions. We have a new extradition treaty with Romania. I hope that that will facilitate arrests and prosecutions in the United States. But you got to remember one thing. There are billions of dollars of internet fraud going on, a lot of it from here in Romania. And the victims, 80% of them, are in the United States. So this is a big issue for the United States. But I must say that your law enforcement here, people here, have done a good job of working with our people and arresting people and bringing them to justice. We'll see what happens when they get in court.
On the other hand, yeah, of course, because in the court, Mr. Gary Dixon, I think he has a problem with the long terms, especially.
Yeah, right.
He complained on the interview that the trials in Romania take too long.
Well, that's why the procedural reforms and the procedural code are so important. That was the reference I made to the fundamental reforms that are being considered right now. I mean, one reform that is essential is that in the United States we have something called interlocutory appeals, where in the middle of a case you can appeal a case all the way up to the Supreme Court. That happens very rarely in the United States. It's the only time it actually happens in the United States often relates to the freedom of the defendant. In other words, if there's a bail decision on his or her pretrial release. It almost never happens otherwise. Here in Romania, as I understand it, you can appeal at any point in the process, stop the whole trial, and there's no, you know, and the trial could be interrupted for months while the court is looking at this issue. That's got to stop. And apparently there's a reform underway that I understand all the parties here in Romania are supportive of. So that's the sort of reform you're going to need to have to require speedy trials and quick convictions here.
His Excellency, the Ambassador of the United States of America, is our special guest at the Monday discussion. President Traian Băsescu has asked for consultation with political parties about the future of honey. But what if, Mr. Ambassador, what if the government fails to pass a new law in the parliament in order to restore a full mandate for honey?
That'll be a big problem. I'm an optimist, and I don't believe that will happen. I think they'll find a way to fix this problem.
But how do you think it's possible to restore the full power of ANI with that decision of Constitutional Court?
You know, I haven't...
I think it's hard to do that.
It may be hard to do that. But I don't want to prejudge what Minister Predoiu is trying to do. I'm not an expert on how your constitutional system works. We had a very bad Supreme Court decision in the United States with respect to corporate contributions, and the senators in the United States Senate have come up with a very clever way of fixing the problem. So there are all sorts of ways to. We're in a very similar situation where you had a constitutional decision that struck down a statute. So there are ways to fix problems that maybe don't have the institution look exactly the same as it did before, but it can perform the same functions.
Good. In the end, I would like to ask you something about the Romanian press.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Ambassador, one of your first statements last year, I remember, was about the positive role of the press in Romania. What would you say now, after more than half a year being in Bucharest, about the Romanian media?
Well, that statement was taken a little bit out of context. What I said is your media is very free to act here, and they are very aggressive, but I said nothing about the fairness. I think there is a lot of bias in your media, as there is in the United States. An example of that is I remember watching your news coverage on the night of the election, and it depended on which channel you were looking at, and they all had their own polling information. And if you were watching one channel that was anti-Băsescu, the polling information was very anti-Băsescu. If the station was pro-Băsescu, it was very pro. And they were supposed to be looking, doing the same polling, which sounded exactly like what would happen in the United States between MSNBC and Fox News.
But true to tell you, Mr. Ambassador, TV station which are pro-Băsescu, I really cannot see.
Well, I can't remember what the name of the station was, but there was one station that seemed to be slightly more pro-Băsescu. There are many more anti-Băsescu stations than there are pro-Băsescu.
Oh, I guess there is one.
Yes, I guess there is one. There was one.
And you're right.
Yeah.
What would you say in particular about the TV news stations? Because, as we know, they have great influence.
I think the same thing is happening to TV news here as happening in the United States. It's becoming, you know, I think it's more like cable news in the United States. Mm-hmm. Each of you has picked out a little segment of the news that you're trying, of the audience you're trying to get, and you just play to that segment. That's what Fox News and MSNBC mm-hmm. does. And so they try and grow that segment and they tend to be very biased. There are, you know, the mainland.
And especially ideologically biased.
Yes, because they've selected an audience segment that they believe mm-hmm. wants to hear that. So,
do you think it's a good thing for Romania to have these ideological TV stations?
You know, I think the solution to the problem is to have more have more media outlets. In other words, rather than try and there's nothing the government can do or should do about this. I think the temptation is to say that somehow the government should regulate the content. That's worse for me. That's the cure that's worse than the disease. On the other hand, if access to the media market is open and, you know, other news media that has their own bias can get into it, that's fine. I think in the end, the solution to this is the audience itself, because the audience is smarter than you think. The ones who are independent and are objective won't listen to the ideologically biased. They know they're getting propaganda. And so that's the solution. So in that sense, the free market is the solution. Now, on the other hand, I know that some people are looking at concentration issues, that, you know, maybe it's sort of the media market is dominated by particular trusts or whatever. That can be looked at as long as they're following an objective standard of concentration. In the United States, no antitrust action is brought usually unless it meets a particular objective index of concentration. And I don't know enough about the concentration in this area to see whether or not there are people trying to dominate this market. I would suspect there are, but, you know, I haven't had an objective analysis of that.
Anyway, do you think that it could be a solution to have in Romania an antitrust law?
I think that it could be, but again, as I said, it's got to be based on evidence of real, concentration that violates, in my mind, what is known as the HI index in the United States, which is a very sophisticated index that looks at any particular market and tries to determine whether someone is trying to dominate that market and whether they're exercising monopoly power. And I don't know the answer to that. I think the real solution to this is the sophistication with which the various media outlets go at the topics and what the audience itself does. And as you and I have discussed this, I think the internet is going to have a huge impact on the media here, because the internet is totally free, and it's very hard for any particular trust or interest to dominate the internet. And as long as the internet stays free, and there are organizations like Hot News out there trying to get their story out, I think audiences are sophisticated enough, and that will undermine any propaganda efforts.